Action.
Good afternoon, you guys.
Good afternoon, speak up.
Is it? This morning?
Jake.
Okay, good morning, guys. Okay, so we're doing chapter 13. Oh my God, where? Empirical evidence on security reasons.
Can you see this? Okay, some formulas, yeah, the expected return and the single factor. They include betas, the returns. Okay.
This is the overview of the investigation. So the capital asset pricing models consist of two parts, the optimal P and the interpreter predictions.
Could you speak up? It's hard to hear from back here.
Sorry. Okay, so the test of the cap M, are expected from the expected return beta relationship. First pass regression, estimate beta, average risk premiums, and non-systematic risk. The second pass uses estimates from the first pass to see if the model is supported by the data.
Okay, Rolle's criticism is the only testable hypothesis whether the market portfolio is mean variance sufficient. We would take the betas, the SNR relationship, and then the cap M is not testable unless we know and use the exact composition of the true market portfolio. The benchmark error is due to the proxy for M.
So this is the measurement error in beta. So if the beta is measured with error, then the slope coefficient of the virtual equation is biased upward and the intersection is biased upward. The solution to that problem is to start P with a large-based dispersion of data. And then by ranking up the yield and cycle test of that summary.
This is just a summary of Ben and Macbeth. The summary of the CAPM test. So for one, expected rates of return are linear and increase with beta, the measure of systematic risk. For two, expected rates of return are not affected by non-systematic risk.
Okay, and then the tests for the multi-factor CAP and APT are three factors: the hedge consumption against uncertainty prices, the future investment opportunities, and the asset missing from the market index. So that's the labor income, the Mayer's model, betas, results in SML, and flat CAP and
So this is the
human
capital and cyclical variations in asset betas. So I'm not even going to try to pronounce that. But two researcher studies showed the two important deficiencies in testing the index model are that many assets are not traded, notably human capital, and the betas are cyclical.
Okay, so early versions of the multi-factor model, Chen, Rolle, and Ross, the factors are growth rate in industrial production, changes in expected inflation, unexpected inflation, unexpected changes in risk premiums on bonds, unexpected changes in term premium on bonds.
Okay, so the type factor models are the high book to market firms experience higher returns, small firms experience higher returns, size and value requires risk factors consistent with APT, and here's just some models to show the average returns, the actual returns versus the returns predicted. Sorry.
So this is a different risk-based interpretations. I can't pronounce it. Liu and Vassilov. I think that style seems to predict GDP growth and what to the business cycle. And then Petkova and Zhang believe in expansion. So growth beta is greater than value beta and then recession. Value beta is greater than growth beta.
So for behavioral explanations for value premium, glamour firms, recent good performance, high prices, and lower book-to-market ratios. For high prices, you have excessive optimism, overreaction, and extrapolation of good news. For studies, you have Chan on just names.
Okay, so the momentum is the fourth factor, the original Femme-French model, which we saw earlier, plus the momentum factor. It evaluates the abnormal performance of the stock portfolio, and the winners, miners, losers is based on past returns. And then,
so for liquidity and asset pricing, liquidity involves trading costs, ease of sale, market depth and credit.
For liquidity and, well, the second part of liquidity and asset pricing. Pass-through and small ball study price reversals may occur when traders have to offer higher purchase prices or accept lower selling prices to complete their trades in a timely manner. In the conclusion, liquidity risk is a price factor.
Okay, so the equity premium puzzle is, it says that historical asset returns are too high and or are usual estimates of high of risk aversion are too low. So basically what matters to investors is not their wealth per se, but their lifetime flow of consumption. Measure risk is the convergence of returns with average consumption.
So this is just explaining the table. So the lower panel shows that a high book to market ratio is associated with the higher consumption beta, and the larger firm size is associated with the lower consumption beta.
Survivorship bias. Risk premiums for the most successful countries without stock markets that did not survive for the full sample period creates an upward bias in estimates of expected returns. Yeah.
Okay, liquidity and equity premium. Part of the equity premium is almost certainly compensation for liquidity rather than just the systematic volatility. And that means that the equity premium puzzle may be less of a puzzle than it first appears.
So this is some behavioral explanations of the premium puzzle. So Barbara Sipmolling explained as a puzzle. Explain the puzzle as an outcome of irrational investor behavior. So the premium is a result of narrow premium loss aversion, meaning investors ignore low correlation of stocks with other forms of wealth and higher risk premium as a result.
Great.
Done.
So chapter 14, we're going to be talking about bond prices and yields.
You don't forget to speak up.
Okay, yes sir. So chapter overview, we're going to be talking about a debt, which is fixed income security characteristics. And we're going to talk about the type of bond, and we're going to talk about the bond pricing, the yield and the time, and the impact of default and credit risk over bond pricing. So bonds are debt that obligate issuers or borrowers to bondholders or creditors. So face or par value is the principal repaid at maturity. The coupon rate determines the interest payment paid semi-annually, and then the indenture is the contract between the issuer and the bondholder that specifies the coupon rate, maturity date, and par value. U.S. Treasury bonds and notes may be purchased directly from the Treasury. They can either be no maturity, 1 to 10 years, or for the bonds, it's going to be 10 to 30 years. And then denomination, which is the face value of a banknote, coin, or postage stamp, can be as small as $100, but is more commonly 1,000. So corporate bonds, there's callable bonds, convertible bonds, putable bonds, and floating rate bonds. For preferred stock, the share characteristics of fixed income and equity. So like fixed income, the payments are typically fixed, and preferred dividends are paid before common. So international bonds. So foreign bonds are issued by a borrower from a country other than the one in which the bond is sold. And then euro bonds are denominated in one currently, usually that of the issue, but sold in other national markets. And then innovation in the bond market, they're now innovating and creating inverse floaters, asset-backed bonds, cash-free bonds, and index bonds. And then this is the equation for bond pricing. So if the price of a 30-year bond is 8% coupon bond, then the market rate of interest is 10%. And here's the equation for that with the numbers plugged in.
Bond prices and yields. Prices and yields have an inverse relationship. The bond price is a curve. The bond price curve is convex. And the longer the maturity, the more sensitive the bond's price to changes in market interest rates. This is showing the relationship between bond prices and yields. And this is the table with bond prices at different interest rates. So this is just the formula for the bond formula for R, and an example for yield to maturity. Yield to maturity, suppose an 8% coupon, 30-year bond is selling for $1,276.76. What is the average rate of return? Plug it in to this formula, and R would be 3% per half year. Bond equivalent yield would be 6%, with the EAR equaling 6.09%. The yield to maturity versus current yield. Yield to maturity, you got bond's internal rate of return. The interest rate equal to its price assumes that all bond coupons can be reinvested at the yield to maturity. And then for current yield, bond's annual coupon payment divided by the bond price. You got premium bonds, the coupon rate over current yield to maturity. And then we got discount bonds, coupon rate is less than the current yield and less than yield to maturity. For bond yields, yield to call. Low interest rates, the price of the callable bond is flat since the risk of a purchase or call is high. High interest rates, the price of the callable bond converges to that of a normal bond since the risk of the call is negligible. This shows the straight bond and the callable bond in relation to prices and interest rates. And then realized yield versus yield to maturity. We got reinvestment assumptions and holding period return. In holding period return, we have changes in rate. Changes in the rates affects the returns. Reinvestment of coupon payments. Change in price of the bond. And then here is growth of investment funds. Invested funds. We got A being the reinvested rate of 10%, and we have B as the reinvested rate being 8%, giving us totals for future value. And then here's a graph of a 30-year maturity bonds for coupon with prices and time. Yield to maturity, it is the average return if the bond is held to maturity. And then HPR, it is the rate of return over a particular investment period. Yield to maturity depends on coupon rate, maturity, and par value. And then HPR depends on the bond's price at the end of the holding period and unknown future value. Yield to maturity, all these are readily observable. and HPR can only be forecasted. And this is another, this is from figure 14.7 with the previous example given showing 30-year zero coupon bond over time, which from today it increases within 30 days.
Next we have the default risk in bond pricing. So that's broken into rating companies as well as rating categories. For rating companies, it's Moody's Investor Service, Standard, Poor's, and Fitch. For rating categories, its highest rating is AAA or AAA. Investment grade bonds rated uppercase BBB or uppercase BAA, and above speculative grade / junk bonds ratings below BBB or BAA. Determinants of bonds safety, so this goes into the coverage ratios, leverage ratios, debt to equity ratio, liquidity ratios, profitability ratios, and the cash flow to debt ratio. So for the financial ratios and default risk by rating class for the long-term debt, shows the graph as mentioned earlier. So it has EBITDA and the assets, the operating profit margin, the EBITDA to interest coverage, debt to EBITDA, debt to over debt plus equity, the funds from the operations, and the retained cash flow. And this is the table from 14.3. This is the discriminant analysis, just shows the ROE over the coverage ratio over time. Next is the definition of the sinking funds, which is a way to call bonds early. Subordination of future debt is also to restrict additional borrowing. Dividend restrictions force firms to retain assets rather than paying them out to shareholders. And collateral can be defined as a particular asset bondholders receive if the firm defaults. Yield to maturity and default risk. The risk structure of interest rates refers to the pattern of default premiums. There's a difference between the yields based on expected cash flows as well as promised cash flows. The default risk premium is the difference between the expected year to maturity and the compromised year to maturity. The Altman Z score on the default risk just shows the equation right here. We have Z is 3.1 over earnings before income taxes over assets plus sales over assets over liability, retaining earnings over assets plus 0.72 times working capital over assets. Where Z is less than 1.23, which is a vulnerability to bankruptcy, and Z is greater than 2.9, it's considered safe. This is the yield spread, so it shows the high yield, the BAA related, and the AAA related from 14.11, which is the spread between the corporate and the 10-year treasury bond from 1970 all the way up to 2018. Next is the default risk in CDs, so credit default swaps, which are CDS, acts like an insurance policy on the default risk of corporate bond or loan. The buyer pays annual premiums, and the issuer agrees to buy the bond in a default or pay the difference between par and market values to the CDs buyers. Credit default swaps, their institutional bondholders use the CDS to enhance creditworthiness of their loan portfolios to manufacture the AAA debt. It can also be used to speculate that bond prices will fall, which basically means that there can be more CDS outstanding than there are bonds to mature. The collateralized debt obligations, or the CDOs, are major mechanisms to reallocate credit risk in the fixed income markets, structured investment vehicles, or SIV, often used to create the CDO. Loans are pulled together and split into tranches with different levels of default risk, and the mortgage-backed CDOs were an investment disaster in the 07, 08, 09 meltdown. And lastly is the collateralized debt obligation, which shows a chart of the senior subordinated tranche structure and the typical terms from 14.3. Thank you.
Thank you.
they will be presenting Chapter 15, the Term Structure of Interest Rates. Easy way to see this is in the yield curve, something that we have to look at every day in class, kind of know where that's trending. The yield curve simply displays the relationship between year to maturity and time to maturity.
So the prices and yields to maturity on zero coupon bonds, when there's a $1,000 face value on a bond, you take that value and divide it by 1 plus the yield to maturity percentage and then put it to the power of the year.
Bond pricing, there's two types of yield curves. There's a pure yield curve and on the run yield curve. Pure yield curve is that it uses stripped or zero coupon treasuries. It may differ significantly from the on the run yield curve, most likely or mainly because the on the run yield curve, it uses recently issued coupon bonds selling at or near par. And that's the one usually published by the financial news.
It's what we see on Yahoo Finance. So the yield curve under certainty. So basically, we have two scenarios. Is it better to buy and hold a 2-year zero interest bond? That would make any sense. I think PowerPoint's wrong. Buy a 2-year bond, zero interest. Why would you do that? That'd be ridiculous. Or buy a 1-year bond and then roll that over into the next year. And that kind of takes us into the next slide.
So there's two-year investment programs. The first scenario is that you buy and hold for the 2-year zero. And the second alternative is you buy a 1-year zero and reinvest the proceeds in another 1-year zero.
The interest rate uncertainty and forward rates. Investors require a risk premium to hold a longer-term bond. And the liquidity premium compensates short-term investors for the uncertainty about future prices. So basically, you're going to be making more money if you buy a longer term bond than the short term bond.
And essentially, to go along with that, is that you don't know what the interest rates are going to be 10 years from now. So if you take a 10-year bond versus a bond today and roll it over 10 times, you're kind of locked in for that 10 years with that amount of money. Obviously, next year you can put more money into another 10-year bond and then have them offset by a year. But there is a little bit of risk involved there, so you'd like the most bang for your buck. Short-term rate and expected future short-term rates. You're just betting that the long-term rate today is going to be better than the short-term rate tomorrow.
So the theories of term structure, one is the liquidity preference theory, where long-term bonds are more risky, and the yield curve has an upward bias built into the long-term rates because of the liquidity premium.
Part one of interpreting the term structure, as we could see the part that's highlighted, if you look at the PowerPoint, the yield curve reflects expectations of future interest rates. The forecasts are clouded by liquidity premiums, and an upward sloping curve could indicate that rates are expected to rise or investors require large liquidity premiums to hold their long-term bonds.
In general, forward rates are not going to equal the eventually realized short rate. But you're locking yourself in for percentage. I mean, unless the United States government falls apart and we descend into anarchy, you're going to get paid back on that premium rate. If you buy a U.S. Treasury bond, obviously.
Bitcoin.
Yeah. So that's nice. And that's it.
Thank you.
Dissertation.
Is that it for everybody?
Yes. 12. Not here, 13, 14, and us as 15. I had to log you out though. Sorry
about that. You did?
It's just solid work.
I had to log into mine so that I could.
Just solid work.
We're signing out mine. But don't worry. I got you. You're right here. Logged family. Because I knew your password.
No, you guys were good. much time do I have?
You got 20 minutes.
20?
Yeah. 22. We'll get out of 50.
Because I have to go over James's. I got to go over James. I don't know. Chiquita, do I have to go over yours too, or are you still working on yours?
I'll finish it up in about 5 minutes.
Okay, and then you need to work with Taylor to get the report, portfolio report, to the class code, right?
Oh, okay. Yeah, got it.
It's not looking at all the ones the same.
I think we updated ours, but I can run. Yeah, we're.
Just make sure.
Okay.
Giuliano.
Got it.
Make sure everybody has the same.
Yeah.
Okay. And then once I sign off on it, then you can print it. But those guys are going to go print theirs. And they'll bring it in, I'll show you exactly how it's going to work.
Okay.
So why don't I continue with this?
Yeah, let's do a lab and like let's get some stuff.
Yeah, and if I have a little time,
cool.
I'll do that.
Awesome.
And then staple them all together second.
Yeah, I fixed.
You should have them. Thank you. This was just the first one this year. And the midterm was all you've started on it.
It's a lot shorter. I feel like two.
Discovering common ground. Monday, Wednesday, I have class. Get done here at work, and then I drive the same amount of class. I'm taking my final language, ASLP. And then Tuesday morning, I don't have class till 1:30. What you got to think about is, there's not a lot of time. Once Tuesday is over, you're back on Wednesday. Develops perseverance, progress, you know? Even if you're just doing it, nothing at all. Just going there and setting the structure of like, you know, chill, just try to be change. It's the mentality, because it's a process. You gotta get there and you gotta get in. I mean, I could write a whole process about like a process going in and out.
Just because I'm rehabbing right now.
Mm-hmm.
When I'm rehabbing, I'm
like, yeah, actually,
of course.
Like, I'm here, he's like, you want to know how to do something this well? Ask me what happened about it.
Yes. Like, when I'm like, don't know what it's like yet. It's a great way to like, but it's like really testing you, like, patient.
Do you medicate at all?
No.
I'm
the see the final version.
I just have like, look at it.
And if you want me to check it,
I'll try. No, you work out your muscles. Your body.
Because I want it to be another way.
Okay. Okay. Thank you.
Meditation just helps a lot. You better slow down.
Okay, James, I'm coming up to you.
I can come back there if you want.
All right, yeah.
Yep. All right. Yeah, it was good talking to you. Yeah. Thanks.
She said they'll take it until the end of next week. What is it? Is it say the 24th?
23rd.
So there? I guess.
I guess that was Monday.
You know, I guess we need it by the end of the week. That's weird that she said that. Sent it to me. This looks like it's unfortunately. Everything's gotta be informal.
And then that is done. Don't just pull out four times.
You might need to stretch.
One, two, three.
And then it goes, 90 days.
When you go in, you get it fine four times. So we'll just go on.
I
Yo, what are you doing?
I just finished that class, so I'm about to.
Oh, really?
Yeah. What conference? This is the
You know what you didn't have? I guess it's for the chapter that you did. Yeah,
I don't want to make a new group message, but.
Yeah, I'll show you what you
do.
Yeah,
I'm sure
you can.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. No, I appreciate it.
Dr. Souza, take care.
All righty.
We'll see you after the break on Monday, all right?
Did you watch the video? show me. Watch the video. There's videos on this. Especially at the beginning of that. So, same thing.
Yeah, no, I saw this one actually. I'll redo it.
Yeah. Just use like blue pad or something.
Okay.
So I should get something in through. And then did you have? This is the Mary Beth went through this. You probably need to get something. Now, you said you were overseeing.
That's so funny. I know, right?
How many demos?
I'm posting that on my story.
You should post it.
Are you done with
the
terms?
Yeah, I have been on this morning.
How'd it go?
Operations management. Okay. Yeah, it wasn't that bad. Like, I called someone today who had it, and he was like, it was so hard. Like, she didn't teach us anything.
Yeah,
I was like, did you go over the
I remember signing off.
Like, things
on
the was a joke. Yeah, it was just
there was
right.
Okay. You
can
put that in there.
That's all.
Because all those numbers.
That's
all
that's
all
this
all
one.
He's like, two other topics. He got like,
you can use.
Okay, well, that's the meeting.
Any of your business.
That's crazy. I didn't even think of that.
Language or logic, you know, you just what you do is you step back. And now that you're in business,
you
can
hear
yourself sold.
Do I
yes,
but
and now when they've hired you, you basically observe.
So we need to sign it.
These operations by this individual,
we
which
can do
you
here.
Need to be analyzing and identifying the value add that this individual created in these environments. In that position, in that
division,
and then you rewrite
how she
does
that.
But you can't,
because I've done some reading, like, just
yeah, usually I do
it
a few minutes before.
Combat veterans, and like most veterans like have crappy resumes because they don't know what to put, but like, I didn't even think about it. I've signed for like, I've been responsible for like multi-million-dollar pieces.
With government,
okay.
Kind of logistics,
equipment,
setting
it
up, deploying it, you know, decommissioning it.
Okay.
You know, you were doing, you were basically doing project management.
And
then you were doing it. So you were overseeing that.
Okay, cool.
Now I would go back.
Thanks for telling me that.
Professor Sinsley, can I ask this out?
Yes. Okay, that's all I need.
That's cool.
Hey, good to see you.
Good to see you.
We'll announce the changes first. If Eleanor doesn't show up, then I have to replace her.
Okay, that's a little intense.
What do you mean?
Well, she was at the last two meetings.
Who?
Eleanor.
Anderson?
The freshman?
Different element.
Oh. There's another one.